So from module 2, already we have discussed conveyance of water, that is, in that we have discussed various types of intake structures and conveying water from the source to the treatment plant. Right? So in that we have discussed various types of pumps, various types of pipes, walls, all the accessories. That also we have discussed in the previous classes. Today we will discuss the various components of municipal water supply related to water treatment plant, and then we will progressively start looking at the each and every unit process and unit operation of the water treatment plant or WTP. Right? So in collection work or from the source, if we look at say various sources of water are there, for wherein we will require various intake structures for drawing or for withdrawing water or taking out the water from the source. Then transmission of that withdrawn water or raw water up to the treatment plant, transmission works either in the form of closed conduits or say open channels or closed pipes that can be utilized. Then the most important part that we are discussing today is treatment or purification of water. Right? Say water treatment plant that we will discuss, and this is the most important pillar in the municipal water supply scheme, which will ensure the quantity as well as the desired quality of water so that it can be safe for consumption for the various end uses, and that end uses may be say for domestic water uses or industrial water uses or any sort of water which is required by the population. Then afterwards the treated water will be conveyed and it will be distributed for the population under consideration or to the consumers through a piped network. Now if you look at the concept of treatment of water, earlier we have seen various characteristics of raw water by which we can be able to design what is the treatment that should be applied so that the quality of raw water will be rendered by giving a proper treatment to that, and the finished water will be of drinkable water and potable water. It should be safe for the specific uses, for the specific intended uses at the end. Not only for drinking, along with that various other demands of water are there, various other uses of water are there. To make the raw water fit for any intended use at the end, there is a role of treatment of water to make the water fit for the specific uses. So in this, what is meant by treatment is say removal of contaminants or pollutants from the water, make it suitable or compatible with the uses. Now in this, various unit operations or various unit processes are involved which are dependent on the raw water quality. Now for distributing or supplying water for a particular city or for a particular locality under municipal water supply system, that raw water is typically obtained either from a surface water in the form of say from river, lakes or any other source of surface water, or it can be drawn from a ground water from deep wells or tube wells. And the water which will be brought from either of the surface or groundwater sources is not up to the mark that can be directly consumed by for various purposes like drinking, cooking, cleaning or any other household uses, and as well as for industrial or recreational purposes or uses. Reason behind this is the water which can be brought from surface and say groundwater sources, it will be having certain sort of contaminants or pollutants, either in the form of soluble or insoluble form. Certain solids are present and heavy metals that are also present in water, which will make the raw water unfit directly for consuming for the various purposes. Now, urban water utilities, which will aim to supply water for household uses, in which household or say domestic demands of water are there, say there will be bathing, cooking, cleaning, along with the main important purpose or demand is for drinking. In that, under Right to Water Act, the water which is available to humans or say people, there are two components or two criteria prescribed, which are the water should be potable or it should be safe to drink, and it should be palatable or it should be aesthetically acceptable for drinking. If water contains or if water has a certain color to that, aesthetically it won't be acceptable for directly drinking, though that color may not be harmful for consumption point of view. Then also the water should be rendered or it should be treated and it should be made palatable or crystal clear water should be consumed for drinking. In the initial lectures we have discussed what are the characteristics of water that can be consumed by for various uses. So in that, the major characteristics or requirement of water is that the water should be free from turbidity or any other suspended solids. Along with that, it should be crystal clear and sparkling clear water. So it should be aesthetically acceptable. Along with that, there should not be any presence of contaminants in that. It should be safe for drinking, as well as by looking at the water which we will consume for drinking, it should be aesthetically acceptable. No one will be ready to drink water which is a turbid one, right? We will prefer the water which is a crystal clear and which is aesthetically good or acceptable for drinking. Now, the water which is supplied to the consumers, it should be meeting certain water quality standards which are prescribed by the regulatory authorities. Say the water quality standards, those are set by few of the national and international agencies. In India, generally we prefer Bureau of Indian Standard or BIS, and IS code for drinking water, the specifications are given in the IS code BIS 10500, published in the year 2012. As a international agency, water World Health Organization, those are also depicting certain acceptable and permissible range of water quality parameters. Right? In US or in other countries, generally US EPA Environmental Protection Agency, these are prescribing certain water quality standards which are to be followed. Now, in regards to the water treatment process, till now we have discussed what is the necessity of water treatment, why to provide treatment to the water. Basic intention is to make the raw water available fit for the end uses or end purposes. Along with this, the standard codes, those are to be also followed from the point of view of safety and acceptability. Now, water treatment for removing certain contaminants or impurities from water, it will rely upon several unit operations or unit processes. We are giving water treatment or treating the water does not mean that or only one such process will not be sufficient to make the raw water directly safe for consumption, and it cannot be able to remove all the contaminants from the water. There are combination of unit operations and processes those are involved in the water treatment plant, WTP. Though we are getting water which is treated at a particular WTP, particularly in India, we are not pretty assured about the quality what we are getting. Therefore, today the market of RO unit or RO plants are being increasing day by day. To avoid this or to make the people aware about what is the quality of water that we are getting at our taps, there should be monitoring or collection of data and monitoring about the water quality at various locations. So this will require a huge study or collection of data as well as monitoring and displaying the reports associated with this water which we are getting at our taps, so that the people will become aware and they will become sure that whatever the quality of water we are getting, it's safe and it will be consumable directly. In other countries, generally the water quality that what they will receive is superior than what we are receiving nowadays. As like the air quality monitoring and the reports are published at some places that you can observe that displays are being provided at various locations, likewise these quality reports related to water quality, those are also to be made available to the people, so that regarding the water quality they will become aware and they will start relying on the municipal water which is supplied by the taps. Now, for treating the water or water treatment process, as we have said, it is inclusive of certain unit operations and unit processes in that. So this will be dependent on the characteristics of raw water which we have to study initially. So water will have certain impurities either in the form of, say, physical form, which are some of the contaminants or solids are present either in the form of suspended solids and colloidal solids. Along with this, there are a certain microbial culture or bacteria are also present in water. Depending on the quality of water and the characteristics, we have to design or prescribe what should be the water treatment provided for the raw water. So under unit operations, it is, say, in this application of physical forces are only predominant. Examples of this, if we can consider only screening and aeration or certainly straining of water so that the solid particles will get separated out from the water, those are under unit operations, in which only physical forces are predominant and it will ultimately lead to the physical separation. So solid part will get separate out from the liquid or say water. Above that, or if we can say above this preliminary and primary treatment, there is a secondary, tertiary or advanced level of treatment which we have to provide. Those are generally categorized as unit processes. So under this unit processes, we have to go for providing chemical or biological treatments for the removal of solids as well as the microbial content from water. To make it safe or to make it fit for consumption, these processes are required. A separate set of unit steps may be chosen, which will be depending upon the source of the water which we are withdrawing from the intake structures and the level of contamination or say level of pollutants present in the raw water. So very first initial thing that we have to look at, we have to characterize the raw water. Then only we can be sure about giving or prescribing what should be the treatment level provided. There are various processes which are to be employed for treating water to make it fit for consumption at various end uses. It will not be mandatory, so that all of these unit processes are to be provided for each and every water treatment plant or WTP. There are various fermentations and combinations that can be made so that the end water or the end quality of water will be suitable or will be acceptable for by the various users. The first unit process or unit operation, rather we can say, is screening and aeration. These are the physical operations which are involved, which are required for separating out the physical contaminants from the water. Only straining mechanism or physically removal of the obstruction that will be considered under the screening, aeration and particular rain sedimentation. In coagulation, coagulants are added or chemical agents are added so as to remove of colloidal solids from the water. And in sedimentation, the flock which will get formed, the size of colloidal solids will be increased by the addition of chemicals or coagulants in the water, and that will get removed in the sedimentation. Then filtration, which is required for removing the bacteria from water. Along with that, disinfection is the most important treatment unit which will be assuring the end water quality is safe and which is free from bacteria, and that is required from after treatment or post treatment. The disinfection is important. Now in this particular slide, a pictorial view of water treatment plant is shown, considering the raw source as the surface water or lake water or river water that we can consider. So surface water is there or source is there, from where water is withdrawn, taken out by intake pipe. So up to this we can consider this as the intake work, and at sometimes there are intake structures that are also to be provided. And these screens which are shown separately over here, preferably these are provided in the intake structures itself, so that while withdrawing the water from the source itself, it will get separate out from the large size particles which are objectionable or which can ultimately, if passes through the pipe, those will create problem in the operation of pumps and other machineries and equipments. Therefore, the screens are provided in the, and those are considered to be as a preliminary treatment. Then after intake structure, after screening, the water is lifted and it will be then further sent to the water treatment plant in the primary treatment. So for various treatment plants, if we will consider, and if groundwater is the source of water, in that important unit that has to be provided is the aeration, as the groundwater doesn't have dissolved oxygen content in the groundwater, whereas in surface water it is not at all mandatory or it is not compulsory that everywhere you have or at every water treatment plant the aeration unit is to be provided. But particularly for a groundwater source, aeration is the most important unit that has to be provided. So, and if we draw a say typical layout of water treatment plant, it will be particularly having aeration, say depending on whether it is a surface water source or a groundwater, we can consider this aeration or we can discard that. Then after aeration, there will be pre-chlorination, or say this chlorination or disinfection that can be done at various stages. Before the start of water treatment, if the chlorine is added from the point of view of disinfecting the water, then it is pre-chlorination. If the chlorine is added or at the end of the treatment, after all the treatment units, then that will be termed as the post chlorination. So this is also optional depending upon the quality of raw water. Then after aeration, there will be addition of coagulants or chemicals in the water so that the solids, colloidal solids which are present in the water, those will get removed off easily. And these addition of chemicals and coagulants are to be mixed with water in a particular unit, and that will be termed as a flash mixer or rapid mix unit. After that, the water along with the coagulants that are added will be further sent to the coagulation and flocculation unit, or at some times the combined unit will be provided for these two units, and that will be termed as clarifloculator unit. So coagulation, flocculation will be in the same unit, and the combined unit for these two will be the clarifloculation. So flocculation will start after adding the coagulant in a particular say tank. Afterwards, the floc will get formed that will be settling at the bottom of the sedimentation tank and will get removed off from the bottom of this tank. The sludge will get removed off. After removing the solids from the water, then the bacteria from the water will get removed in a unit called filtration unit, wherein the water is passed from various layers of gravel, sand, and a carbon layer, or say anthracite or any other bed will be provided. Now, after filtration, there is a disinfection unit. A common example of disinfection will be in the sort of chlorine that can be added as a disinfectant. Then for the removal of fluorides or other objectionable matter or metal from the water, the extra units that can be provided. But in general, these are not provided for a common water treatment plant. After treating the water at various level, that is from preliminary in the primary treatment, that is for aeration and addition of coagulants, in the secondary treatment after sedimentation and filtration, and at a disinfection unit, then the clear water will be stored in an elevated storage reservoir or overhead water storage. And by there, after that, the water will get distributed to the area under consideration, either under gravity, or if it is at a higher level, the distribution area is at a higher level, then pumping may be required. So in this particular slide, a simplified form or say flow sheet of water treatment plant is being shown, indicating various treatment units. Say preliminary treatment units that will be in the form of screening and aeration are required. Then in the primary treatments, we have to provide coagulation, flocculation, and sedimentation, or a combined unit that can be provided as a clarifloculator. Then filtration, chlorination, and supplementary treatment or advanced treatments that may be required. Now, if you look at the various water treatment system, a general flow sheets are now being shown in the subsequent unit by considering the surface water as a source, and the another treatment plant that we are going to discuss is by considering the source as a groundwater source. Now, in surface water treatment system, the same things again we are going to see it in another form. So water source is there either in the form of lake, river, or any surface water available. Preliminary treatment will be required in the form of screening and aeration at some places, and these screens are predominantly provided in the intake structures itself. So up to this, there will be intake structure. Then the water is taken to the treatment plant, wherein say coagulants are added after aeration, or in the aeration also it is possible to add the coagulants. Once the coagulants are added, those are to be mixed at a very high speed with the water, and further the formation of flock will get that will get observed in the flocculation unit. Ultimately, the flock which will get formed or separation of the colloidal solids will be in the sedimentation tank. And from the bottom of sedimentation tank, the settled sludge will get taken out or disposed of. After sedimentation, there will be a filtration unit which is provided in the layers of sand, gravel and carbon layers or anthracite unit that has to be provided. And final treatment or final disinfection is provided before the water is allowed to enter in the distribution system. Then from this, there will be a distribution system or distribution of water to the end users. Now, if we particularly look at the raw water source available as a groundwater, then there will be a slight modification in the treatment that we can consider depending on the source as the groundwater. So, groundwater is there, or water which has been taken out from aquifers. So, it is not exposed to atmosphere, air will not be added, or there is minimum amount of oxygen present in the water. Dissolved oxygen is one such characteristics of water, or one such the characteristics of water which is indicating the level of purity and freshness of water. If it is a groundwater we are considering, then the dissolved oxygen content will be at a certain low level. Therefore, enhancement of oxygen content with the help of aeration is very important in the groundwater treatment system. So, after aeration, again there are common treatment processes are to be provided as we have discussed in the surface water treatment. So, there will be addition of coagulants or chemical coagulants with the help of unit as rapid mix unit or flash mixer. Then the flocculation unit, or that has to be optional if say groundwater is having certain solids present in that. Generally, the groundwater that passes through a certain stratum, therefore the chances of solids present in the groundwater is minimum compared to the surface water. Therefore, addition of coagulants particularly and the removal of colloidal solids is not a predominant one in the groundwater treatment system. More important is enhancement of oxygen content in the groundwater with the help of aeration unit, and then filtration and disinfection are the required treatment processes provided for groundwater. Then a particular or say typical groundwater treatment, if we have to summarize in this way, a groundwater or any sort of water, if it is present, surface water is there, water influent which has been taken out with the help of intake structures, it has been brought to the water treatment plant. Then under preliminary treatment, there is a screening, then aeration is to be provided, rapid mix unit or addition of coagulants is there in this unit particularly, then flocculation basin and sedimentation, afterwards filtration and then disinfection, and then treated water will be entering to the distribution system. Now, as in this screening unit, it is most important in the wastewater treatment plant rather than this water treatment plants. As the solids content or say objectionable matter present in the surface water is comparatively less if we compare it with the wastewater treatment. So these objectionable matter or floating matter generally will be separated out at the source itself or at the intake structure itself. Then the next unit in the water treatment plant is particularly aeration. By the name itself, we can say understand that it is certainly addition of air into the water. Or in other words, if we can say, aeration is nothing but bringing the water in contact with the air or rather oxygen, so that the dissolved oxygen content will get enhanced. Along with that, it will remove certain objectionable taste and odor from the water. Along with this removal of taste and odor, the aeration unit will result in removal of minerals such as iron and manganese, which are generally present in the form of carbonates in the surface waters. Along with this removal of taste and odor and certain minerals, aeration is capable of removing certain objectionable gases, for example, carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide from the water. Two main actions involved in aeration are scrubbing and oxidation. Aeration that can be done in two ways, that the air that can be bring into contact with the water that can be bring into contact with the air, or air that can be passed through the water. In both the ways, ultimate motto is to enhance the oxygen content or air content in the water. So if in a detailed manner, if we will discuss the objectives of aeration, is the three main objectives or intentions of aeration that we have discussed, it as it will be able to remove the taste and odor, it will remove iron and manganese from water or certain minerals from water. Along with that, objectionable gases such as hydrogen sulfide and odor associated with that and carbon dioxide, that will again removed by aeration. So same things have been incorporated in this particular slide. And at some places, the aeration that will also be used for adding coagulants with the water. Now, how this particular aeration unit work, or how the air will get added into the water? So aeration, that is nothing but the intimate exposure of water with the air. It is the way by which the air and water will get thoroughly mixed with each other, so that the ultimate the reactions that can occur in between the gases which are present in the water and the minerals which are present in the water, those will get removed off very easily by the oxidation process. The aeration is effective against the removal of dissolved gases such as iron and dissolved gases such as carbon dioxide, and it will be in the most effective in the removal of iron and manganese. The taste and odor problems which are associated with methane and hydrogen sulfide, if these are present in water, it will impart objectionable taste and odor to water. Aeration will also remove these taste and odor. Then volatile organic compounds, VOCs, are generally removed because of aeration. Then the precipitates of iron and manganese that can be formed, and these are very easily removed once it will become insoluble in water if oxidation of these will happen. Then aeration is capable of raising the pH of water certainly, as the oxygen content will get added into that. The aeration is not much effective in the removal of other heavy metals. It can remove iron and manganese, but other heavy metals it cannot remove. Some pathogenic bacteria or disease causing organisms that can also that cannot be removed by aeration, but for removal of this we have to provide filtration unit. Aeration does not remove any sort of solids or suspended matters and associated turbidity of that. As we have said, the aeration mechanism of aeration, now we will discuss. The aeration will remove or modify the constituents of water by using two actions or two methods, and those are scrubbing action and oxidation. So scrubbing action, that is movement of water particles over one another. And because of this scrubbing action, the air or certain objectionable gases will get removed off from the water. The gases will escape from the raw water and it will go into the surrounding air. So this is a physical operation or physical action involved in aeration, which is resulting in escape of gases from water. So the scrubbing action will remove gases and the associated taste and odors, for example, for hydrogen sulfide, which has a smell or bad odor of, say, that will get removed by this scrubbing action. Oxidation is the another process through which the iron and manganese will get removed off from water. So this we are going to discuss it with the help of chemical reactions also. And when air is mixed with the water, some impurities as iron and manganese will become oxidized. The precipitate of these will be observed and that will get settled down at the bottom and this can be removed off very easily. So how this will work? It's shown in this pictorial format. Say a raw water is there, which is shown over here, is having carbon dioxide in the raw water along with iron present and certain gases as hydrogen sulfide is present in the raw water. When this raw water passes through the air, or say air is passing through this raw water, what happens? The gases which are there in the raw water, that is carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide, those will get evolved very easily because of scrubbing action in the aeration unit. Then the remaining part, that is iron and manganese, or say heavy metals which are present in the water, those are oxidized and those will become insoluble in water, and precipitate of iron and manganese will get settled out at the bottom, and in the subsequent units this can be removed very easily. So in scrubbing action, this will be caused by the turbulence when the water is being mixed with the air. It removes odor and taste because of hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide and other volatile organic compounds. In the oxidation process or in the oxidation action, it is caused by the action of dissolved oxygen, or say oxygen which is present in the water. In this phase of oxidation, impurities such as iron and manganese will get oxidized and precipitate of those will get formed. Then the efficiency of aeration will depend on entirely or mainly on the surface area which is exposed to air or atmosphere, so that there will be proper exchange of air and oxygen with the water, and more will be the efficiency in that manner. So this contact of air and water is controlled primarily by the size of water droplet or air which will get entrapped in the form of air bubbles. The main goal of an aerator is to increase the surface area of water. More exposure should be given for water so that it will come in contact with air, and enhancement of oxygen content or air content in the water will be resulted. Now how iron and manganese will get removed off in the aeration unit is given in this particular slide. Say iron and manganese in the well water occurs as a soluble form of ferrous and manganese carbonates. So this is particularly observed in well water or ground water. Ferrous carbonate and manganese carbonate, if it comes in contact with oxygen, oxidation of that one will result and ferric hydroxide or manganese oxides or precipitates are being formed, and the other things or carbon dioxide or other gases will get evolved very easily, and at the end we will get a treated or say iron and manganese free water will be sent for further treatment. The oxidation products or by the end products of the chemical reaction that we will get are ferric hydroxide and manganese dioxide. These are insoluble in water. Therefore, these are removed by clarification or filtration units, which are in the further treatment processes. There are various types of aerators. If you look at the classification, free fall or gravity type of aerators, in which the water is allowed to fall or allowed to flow under gravity. In spray aerators, water is brought in contact with air in the form of spray. Then air diffusers, in which at the bottom of aeration tank air diffusers are provided, which are adding air into the water. There are some types of mechanical aerators, those are also to be, that can also be provided, which will act as the surface aerators. So again, one more slide indicating various types of aerators. Under gravity type of aerator, there are examples or various types are given: cascade aerator, inclined apron aerator, slat tray aerator, and gravel bed aerator. In cascade type of aerator, it is the simplest form of gravity type of aerator. It can be constructed either in the concrete or metal. Height of this one is particularly say 1 to 3 meter. 50 to 60% of carbon dioxide that will get removed by this type of cascade aerators. So cascade aerator is nothing but say water or raw water is allowed to come in contact with air with the help of these steps like structure which is provided. So the water is allowed to fall from one step to another, and these are the cascades which are provided, and ultimately the aerated water is collected in this tank and it will be then further sent to the further unit. So cascade aerator photographs are shown in this particular slide. So water is falling from one step to another, and ultimately it will get collected at the collecting channel. So this is the rectangular type of cascade aerator, and in this circular type of cascade aerator is shown. Generally, circular type of cascade aerators are provided at various water treatment plants. So there will be a collecting channel or collecting aerated water will get collected from the periphery of entire cascade which is provided. Then second type is inclined apron aerator with the reefers. So this will be same as the earlier one or cascade type of aerator, but instead of providing steps for the aeration, here is a straight apron provided, and the water is allowed to flow over the reefer plates which are provided, so that some turbulence will be created in the water and more air will get added to the water. Right, so water falls along the inclined apron, but the turbulence or agitation will be in the form of reefers which are provided or obstructions which are created in between these apron. Then slat tray type of aerator, in which number of trays are provided and the water will generally flow from one tray to the next or subsequent tray. Then gravel bed aerator, in which water is allowed, or say water is sprayed at the top and it allows to trickle down on the bed of coke or anthracite. This anthracite is nothing but hard coal, which is generally used for filters and other units, over which the water will allow to trickle. Thickness of this bed is restricted to 1 to 1.5 meter. So the water is allowed to trickle on this top of anthracite bed or coke bed. The next variety is trickling beds. 3 to 4 trays are kept filled with coke or stone or anthracite stone. Thickness of this bed is generally 0.5 to 0.6 meter and distance between the trays is 0.5 meter. So there are number of trays provided and the water will trickle from one tray to the another one, and from the bottom the aerated water will get collected. Then the spray aerators are there, in which the water is sprayed or thrown into the atmosphere with the help of orifices or nozzles, which are mounted on a stationary pipe system. So it will look like, or it will be say like a fountain that we will generally observe. So spray aerators are there. These generally require relatively larger area to collect the aerated water. So diffused air aeration system, in which the diffusers are provided at the bottom of tank, in which, as like in the earlier methods of aeration, the water is brought in contact with the air. In diffused air system, air is entrapped into the water from the bottom, right? So mechanical aerators are shown over here. It can be a vertical shaft or a horizontal shaft. In any direction, these can be provided. So by producing a large air-water interface, the transfer of oxygen from atmosphere is enhanced. So mechanically, the air will get added into the water for aeration. So this was related to today's content. If you have any query, or if you have not understood any part, then we can discuss now.